So you guys have been writing me and emailing me saying that you want a video all about how to take care of sulcata tortoises. Well, we've listened to you here at Kamp Kenan, so today I'm gonna teach you how to go from this to the third largest tortoise species on Earth, sulcata tortoise. A good portion of my life has been all about action, which still holds true. But now I pour all that time and energy into wildlife conservation, education, and the pursuit of knowledge. This is Kamp Kenan. All right, so you've gone to the pet store, you've gone to the reptile show, or you've bought or been looking for a breeder online and you want to get a sulcata tortoise. First things first, you have to know that these little guys right here grow very quickly and they will become a 100-pound tortoise in about 10 years. So you're looking at an animal that's going to require a lot of space. So please be smart. Don't get one of these animals if you don't live in a southern climate where you can provide a nice outdoor backyard, kind of like I have out here for the adults. But here we go, starting things off. This little guy here is only about a month old, and sulcatas are very hardy tortoises, which is part of the reason they're so popular. These guys start eating right away, they're very active, and they're also very beautiful little babies. And the term sulcata is Latin for sculpted, and that animal definitely looks sculpted. If you look at his front legs here, they have a lot of furrows, a lot of ossification on the scales, and in the wild, this little guy would hide and dig a small burrow to get out of the extreme sun of the Sahara, which is on the southern fringe of the Sahara Desert. So these are a semi-desert species to desert species. This is an animal that likes it drier. However, as we're going to find out right now, dry doesn't mean no water. All right, so this is what we got to do. First things first, there's a lot of tortoises in here. I just wanted to kind of show off to you guys, and plus it looks more exciting when you see a bunch of them moving around. But a tub this size is what I would recommend for 1 to 4 baby tortoises right here. This is a Rubbermaid 50-gallon stock tub. Now you can buy these on Amazon. You can also get them at tractor supply companies. And I like them because they're solid, they're easy to clean, and I can lift this whole thing up, get the animals outside for some nice natural sunlight, which has the good UVB for them. So basically you want to set it up in this way. This particular tub I have set up with some cypress mulch and organic potting soil mixed in. It's very important to mix the two because what'll happen is, as we know, tortoises, even from the desert, search out something called a microclimate. I don't care if you're a redfoot tortoise, if you're a spider tortoise, or if you're a sulcata tortoise that lives in a dry environment, your goal is to retain moisture and to search out these small little microclimates. So when you add potting soil to this substrate, to the cypress mulch, and you mist it down, it retains humidity. Another important thing about humidity, guys, check this out. If you look underneath the hide, I have some sphagnum moss right here. Now I moisten that daily and I give the animals an opportunity to choose. Do they want a moist environment? Do they want a drier environment? It's all about these animals being able to move in and out of thermal gradients or microclimates in order for them to feel comfortable. And they know what their body needs. Now you can get this stuff at your home improvement stores. They call it orchard moss. It comes in a brick like this. You'll open a little up, moisten it, squeeze out the excess, place it underneath the hide. Another thing I like to do with some of the other species and even the sulcatas is I'll take this, moisten it, mix it in with the substrate so that when you do mist this down, which is something I love to do all the time, I make it rain for these guys, you mist them down, this will increase the humidity. I like to do this once a day, believe it or not, because to me it replicates dew in the desert. And I'll even see these guys get so excited. They wake up because, hey, when it rains in the desert, it's not a common occurrence. But these animals live in areas where there is a monsoonal season. So when it rains, temperatures drop, they can be comfortable, move around, and they also drink a lot when it rains like this. So these guys get really happy. I'll see them drinking the water that rolls down off their necks and shells. They're able to slurp it up. So it's very important you mist these guys down once a day, a good misting, but you want to mist them and make sure that it can dry off in a couple of hours. You don't want them to be sopping wet. Another thing about hydration, so important, is you always, always, always have fresh water available for them to drink when they want. So you can see it's a basic setup. We've got a hide We've got a flat rock that I use. And by the way, guys, when I pull this whole thing indoors, I have a grate that goes over it with a linear UVB light, because the linear lights, in my opinion, spread it out over way more of an area, so the animal's getting more UVB, and then a UVB basking light over this rock. And what happens? What happens when you touch the pavement on the ground after the sun's been shining on it? It's very warm. So the tortoises all congregate on this rock. They bask, raise their temperatures, and then they move about their habitat. You can also add a few plants if you'd like in some pots, give them a little environmental enrichment. But this is basically the nursery. So this is a simple way and cost-effective way for you to get involved in tortoise keeping and to raise up a healthy animal. Now, when we move on to diet with tortoises, variety is very important. You don't have to go totally crazy, but you never want to feed one food all the time. Sulcata tortoises are what you would consider a grassland species, similar to your Russian tortoise, your Greek tortoise, and also, you can see behind me, some of the leopard tortoises, okay? And beyond them, we're going to get out there in a little bit when I show you the adult sulcatas. But you notice, there's grass. These animals constantly are moving about their environment, nibbling on grass. Grass and weeds don't have a lot of nutritional value, so these animals constantly are taking it in. So when we feed them our store-bought produce, those veggies have way more nutrients than those animals would ever see in the wild. So it's very important not to overfeed your tortoise. I like to feed the babies a little bit every day, or you can do a once every other day feeding, just increase the food. This way the animals are not taking in too many calories and storing it as fat, and which could potentially lead to some of that pyramiding that you'll see in captive tortoises. Now don't freak out. Everyone freaks out over pyramiding. A little pyramiding is kind of going to happen. It can be caused by growing them up too quick, low hydration, which is why we talked about getting a humid hide. Also, you feeding them the wrong foods can cause pyramiding, and not enough UVB lighting. And a diet too high in protein can also affect the growth of the shell. I tend to feel that having the humid hide and slow, steady feeding for slow, steady growth is what's gonna be the most beneficial for these animals. So a tub like this, it's gonna cost you about $80. You might be able to find one on Craigslist a little bit cheaper. This one was actually used. I kind of found it in the garbage. It's amazing what people throw away. But any solid walled structure that has walls high enough for the animal to not climb out of is very important. It can work. You can take an old bookshelf, lay it on its side, reinforce the back of it, and you've got a tortoise table. Also, Google tortoise table. Check out what other people have created. Just make sure the walls are high enough. Now, I'm outside. I like to bring them outside for some of that natural Florida sun. This isn't the prettiest lid, and it's not exactly the most secure, but for the sake of our video here, I want to give you an idea of what you can build to keep any predators from above from reaching these beautiful little babies on the inside. So you want to just have something that you can actually secure these guys with, so you don't wind up feeding the local hawks and birds a very expensive and cute hors d'oeuvre. Let's be safe with our baby tortoises. Believe me, if you think it can happen, it will happen. Animals are notorious for getting into trouble, and these are babies. So remember, babies are just like baby humans. They get into a lot of mischief. You'll see them flip over a lot. So if you're gonna do something where this animal is outdoors, I recommend putting it underneath a covered patio so rain doesn't drench them, so that if it's sunny and they do flip over, hopefully they flipped over in an area where there's not a lot of sun. You don't want them just to be pelted. Again, I'm out here doing a video. I'm watching these guys, and we needed the bright light for the video's sake, but I would put this enclosure half in, half out of the sun, just to give them, again, what? The option to move in and out of those thermal gradients and microclimates. So we've got that. Very important also now to move into a little feeding. I kind of wanted to show you guys what I do. Now, I live in South Florida. I don't recommend you get sulcatas if you live north of North Carolina. It just gets too cold. It's very difficult to keep them. You know, these are relatively inexpensive tortoises. I sell them online for about $80 a tortoise plus shipping, and I don't like to ship them up north. I really don't. And I try and talk people out of it, because I don't want you to be an impulse buyer. $80 today will cost you thousands of dollars later on when this animal gets big. So use your head. don't buy an animal you're not ready to care for the next 80 to 100 years and pass along to your children and their children. You get what I'm saying? Because 80 bucks now, I'm telling you guys, the fencing that's around my property, very, very expensive. But I'm dedicated, I love these animals, and hey, if you can provide them with a great home, I'm all for it. There's actually more of these animals here in the United States than in their native range of the Sahel in Africa. And so to me, that's a good thing because we've provided a very stable environment for this species. But anyway, let's get to some feeding. I got a cactus pad and some hibiscus flowers, excuse me, leaves here. And what I like to do, now you can either, with these leaves, since they're not wet, you can go and just snip, snip, snip like this. All right, I just snip them into smaller pieces and I let them fall on the substrate. Now usually you guys are going to want to get some kind of feeding dish that's easy for them to crawl in and out of. Same thing with your water dish. It's got to be easy for these tortoises. As you can see, look at this, come on down here, this little guy just flipped over. So accidents will happen, so you got to be prepared for that. You want something that's easy for these animals to get in and out of. And the reason I say get a dish for these tortoises is if you're feeding them some of the fruits, or excuse me, some of the veggies that are a little bit more moist, some of the substrate could potentially get stuck to it and they can get an impaction. But this, as you'll notice, doesn't really stick. And look down here, immediately these little guys are eating. And that's what you want to look for when you're looking for a baby. You want to buy from a reputable breeder. And you also, if you do get one from a pet store or from a reptile show, make sure the animal is active, it's moving around, make sure that they'll eat. All my animals will eat, whether at their show, whether they're at home, wherever they are. These animals are not stressed, they're healthy, they're happy, they're moving around. So you want to look for that. Bright eyes, movement, they're eating. I love this. This is what most people love seeing baby tortoises eat. So I snip this all around for them. They get a little bit of that. And then you can get some cactus. You can find this at Latin supermarkets. It's spineless prickly pear, Opuntia, smooth cactus it's called. Google it. And I just snip a little bit of this. And this is really good because it's got hydration and it's got a lot of nutrients for them, but it's a natural type of nutrient. You can't really overdo it with this stuff. But then again, never feed just one food, right? We got some hibiscus today, we got some cactus today. You can also feed these guys mulberry leaves, endive, turnip greens, dandelion greens, collard greens, yellow squash for vitamin A, just shred it up. You're also gonna feed these guys zucchini a little bit, you know, and a lot of people will say don't feed Sulcata tortoises fruit, but I'm gonna break from that tradition and I'm gonna tell you, I feed my babies and my adults watermelon and cantaloupe from time to time, maybe once every couple of weeks, because it's so high in water, it's a great way to give these animals metabolic moisture that they need. Because one of the big problems with any dry loving species is people think, oh, it only needs to drink once a year. That is not true. These animals will drink water when it is available. The whole goal in the desert is to find water. So you gotta make sure they have enough water to keep their kidneys hydrated, or else they'll get kidney stones, impactions of those urates, and they'll die from renal failure. So very important to do that. I think we're covering pretty much everything on the babies. There's a lot of information here. There's plenty more for you to find out, but I want you to do your research. You can always ask questions on the bottom of this video. But now, why don't we move away from the babies and start showing you what happens when the tortoises get big. Okay, so once your tortoise gets to be about that big, the animal then is safe from predators that can fly away with it or chew its arms and heads off. So I like to get them outside as soon as possible. Now, we're actually standing inside the Sulcata enclosure here at my house. You'll notice there's water. I got it on a sprinkler system. Comes on a timer. It fills up with fresh water. Very important. Remember, always have that water available. You can use large terracotta plates as a water source. You can fill that up. Just make sure it's clean. I like to build things, so what I've done is made those cement structures. But here's what you can expect from large sulcatas. This is my female number 6. I don't have a name for her. Her name's number 6. This is why this tortoise is not for everybody. You see, she's dug herself a mini burrow here. Now, she can't go any deeper because this cypress tree has got such an incredible root structure. But she's dug herself a mini burrow. Now, it's springtime here in South Florida. I don't really worry about two things. I don't worry about the cold, so I don't mind her sleeping out under the stars. And I also don't mind about this burrow collapsing. Here in South Florida, we get a lot of rain. You got to be careful if you are going to allow your sulcata tortoises to burrow and stay in those burrows all the time. I've actually lost sulcatas because when it rained, it filled up, collapsed the roof, and they've drowned in there. But this is also one of the reasons why some people, and this tortoise isn't for everyone, many people have manicured lawns. They don't want to see them dug up. Now, this is a very large enclosure. There are 11 adult tortoises in this enclosure. It's 300 by 150 feet, so it's quite large. These animals mow the entire thing. So, nutritionally speaking, their diet is essentially the same as a baby or an adult. You want to, with the babies, of course, make things easier for them to eat. I give the babies also, we were talking about, I actually give the babies calcium twice a week. The adults take calcium a different way. It may not be cost effective for you to buy large tubs of the Reptile or Zoomed products to sprinkle on the food, but you can also go to a feed supply store, get oyster shell, and sprinkle that down, and they'll actually eat a little bit of it. So let's walk over here and I'll show you a little bit more about this enclosure. Lots of trees for shade. In fact, some of these trees give off so much shade the animals will congregate during the hottest part of the day. Remember, they're ectotherms, they're cold-blooded, so these animals are going to move in and out of thermal gradients, right? Looking for those microclimates we learned about. This tree gives off plenty of shade, and they'll congregate during the hottest part. They'll eat some of the leaves. All this grass, it's just a field mix. It's just a mixture of different grasses, and these animals eat it all. I only feed these guys twice a week, and I'll feed them hay, Missouri tortoise diet, some produce, but mostly, guys, it's this grass. 70% of their diet is going to be them walking around grazing. And remember what I said, that's what these animals are evolved to do, programmed to do by nature. They want to just eat this grass. They have a very long digestive system. They keep it in there a very long time, and that is what enables them to extract as much nutrient as possible. And here, we just caught one of the females eating some of the grass right now, and this is a really nice gal. This is actually number 5. We went from number 6 to number 5. But again, these animals have really nice shell growth. Some of them have slight pyramiding, but I don't want you to worry so much about that, because as I said, in captivity, you're gonna encounter some pyramiding. Guys, here's another thing. Before I got these tortoises, these animals burrowed a lot. Well, what happens to a shell or a rock when you're rubbing against it all the time? It gets smoother. There is an element of them burrowing that will help wear down some of that pyramiding. So you can even see here when she gets bred, she's got a smoother shell as well. So erosion definitely comes into play. So in captivity, they don't have the ability all the time to burrow, so they'll probably get some raised scutes, which is no big deal. I've spoken about this before in the winter time. This is a large species of tortoise. They do not hibernate. So many people will say, well, it'll just hibernate in the winter. No, it won't. It'll go dormant for a short period of time, but never into a true deep hibernation or brumation. So what I do to make it easier on me, my girlfriend, and my back is, if I know it's going to be cool or rainy, which is definitely something you don't want to get a sulcata exposed to, cold and wet days, I kind of shut this and I leave them in a smaller enclosure so it's easier for me to get them into their barn. So again, I know I've mentioned this also and I've been slacking. If you guys are big fans of Kamp Kenan, you'll notice this door's been broke for quite some time. That's because, to be perfectly honest, my neighbor is a really good carpenter and I haven't bugged him to help me how to fix the bottom yet. But it's already summer again, so I'm not so stressed on it. So anyhow, you can look in here, and here are two of the big boys. There's Mahoney and there's Lumpy hanging out. They're chilling out here. They get more active towards the afternoon. And as I said, it's kind of the hot part of the day, so they're in here cooling off. So you're gonna need something not necessarily this big if you only have two or three of these tortoises, or one. You wanna get something that can keep the rain off of them, that you can heat easily if you have cooler nights, especially if you live somewhere like Arizona, Texas, someplace where you know it's gonna drop into the cool temps. You wanna be able to lock them in for that period of time that it's cold at night or sometimes during the day. So I've just insulated this with some rigid insulation. I suspended a heater and it keeps it nice and toasty at about 70 degrees even when it's about 40 outside. And here in South Florida, those temps only come every so often. So anyhow, very important to make sure the animal has shelter. This will also keep them from actually burrowing down. Again, I love these tortoises and it's so impressive, but remember, they're big, they're strong, they've blown through. In fact, just last week, they blew through some of this fence. So if you don't have strong fencing, you're in trouble. I've seen these tortoises pull apart chain link. In fact, let me show you some farm fencing, if I can shut this. Let me show you some farm fencing that I'm gonna need to contend with. Look at this. So this is just how powerful these tortoises are. You notice there's cactus there? That's like torture because they just wanna decimate that cactus. But look what they've done. This is very strong wire fencing and they've pulled it right out. I'm gonna have to get back in and attach this and run some boards to further dissuade them from smashing through. I also have cement on the other side to keep them from getting all the way through. So it's a lot of work. I've moved boulders to make this fence secure. I've also sunk the fence into the ground. It has to be sunk in about 18 inches to be effective because they can dig. And if it rains, it'll collapse the other side, and now you have tortoises going everywhere. But hey, why don't I show you another example of a tortoise shed when we go visit the B group of sulcatas that I have on the other side of Kamp Kenan. Okay, so a thing to consider when getting a sulcata is to make sure that you have tortoises of the same size. Now, I have a bunch of tortoises, 22 in all, and the group of 11 that are over here actually are much larger and an established group. This new group are smaller females and a couple smaller males, and it's important that I don't mix the two because since the pecking order has already been established, I could upset everything, and that could cause a lot of fighting, a lot of tipping over of the smaller males here, like this guy right here. He's just not quite as tough as Lumpy and Mahoney over there. And the other thing is, and I've had this happen sadly, I actually had a 150-pound tortoise Zeus killed by my 90-pound male because his gular projections were just so pronounced. He was actually able to get up there and he murdered his brother. So it was a little Cain and Abel story there, and it's kind of a bummer, man. So it's important to make sure that you keep balanced groups. Don't throw a large tortoise in with a small one. The small one's gonna pay the price, trust me. But you can see there's grass in here, lots of shade, lots of space, but I wanted to show you guys Hercules. So again, here's a quick little water feature I have, and there's a case in point. There's one of the males taking a drink. You don't see it often, guys, but it does happen. Tortoises drink, man, so that's perfect. We just happened along that. The thing that I have found, if you want to stimulate them to drink, since these are animals that there's not a lot of standing water in their environment, they get water from the sky, so it collects in puddles. The puddles are agitated. When you agitate the water, either by the springs coming on or a sprinkler coming on or a hose dripping, then it actually agitates the water and draws the tortoise's attention to it. Okay, let me get off this coconut palm tree. Here's Hercules. Yes, I plant all kinds of hibiscus just on the sides here so I can rip it off and throw it down, and Hercules is gonna look down there and start munching away. So it's very important. You're gonna become an amateur botanist. I pull weeds as well. This is Brazilian pepper, they don't need it. But anyhow, what you do is you plant your edibles on the outside of the enclosure, because if you plant it on the inside, they will not grow. So essentially, that's what needs to be done. There's Hercules having a snack. Just wanted to show you a smaller tortoise house. These just giving you guys ideas of what you can do for some of your large tortoises. But the best thing to do is to know what you're getting involved in. You want to make sure that you start with a small tortoise so that you can learn as the tortoise grows. It can be very difficult to go from, you know, right into a 100-pound tortoise and try and get everything going. So I hope this video has helped you out. It's been a lot of fun to share with you. This is the Sulcata Habitats here at Kamp Kenan. Watch out, Tom. You don't want to step on the turds. They are quite large. Another reason to seriously consider getting a sulcata tortoise. Is it right for you? Only you can make that decision. But one thing's for sure, make sure whatever decision you make, it's right for the tortoise. Thanks so much. I'll see you next time on another Kamp Kenan episode. Later.